that we cover that in case anybody has a question about why you should document. We're also going to go over an overview of Doxygen, just a little bit, to talk about where we came from. And then we're going to introduce DoxyPress. The majority of this talk, though, is talking about parsing. Since we're all here at the C++ conference, we are going to be talking about how the parsing works in Doxygen and DoxyPress, and where we're going with that, and make some future plans. So the question is, who needs documentation? The answer is yes, everybody. If you're not documenting, you should be documenting. People need to read documentation whether we like it or not. It is probably one of those things that it's like, not everybody wants to do it, but it's required. It's required because you've got developers using your applications or your libraries. You also need documentation for yourself. There's no question that 6 months down the road, you're going to go back and look at your products or look at something. And if you don't have documentation, you're not going to probably remember exactly what you did.
There are a lot of things that need to be documented. And when most people look at how should I document my code, the first thing they think of is classic method level documentation. And that's great, and it's really important to have your classes and methods documented, but it's not enough. You need documentation on your tool chain, how your application is built. One piece that's often overlooked is some documentation of the overall architecture of the system. Because without an overview of how the system is constructed, it's very difficult to extrapolate from the individual pieces how the system is built. And examples are extremely useful as well.
When do you create the documentation? Again, this is day one. When we were starting with CopperSpice and DoxyPress, I was a real stickler for documentation before anything else. Well, we got the names of the products, the websites, and then documentation before code was written. Answer was like, this is a little awkward. I'm like, trust me. If you haven't started your documentation now, whatever your project is, start it. It's never too late, but you should usually start it right away because it is a pain to retrofit documentation in your product.
And how do you know if you've done a good job using developing your documentation? Is when you can actually use it in the course of working on your code, refer to it regularly, you will make sure it's accurate. You will also speed up the development process because you won't have to read your code as many times. It's often easier to memorize documentation because it's a more condensed form than to memorize the code itself. And the more out of sync your documentation gets, the worse this problem becomes, and there becomes a real inertia to generate correct documentation once it's become too far out of date.
We actually had an issue with CopperSpice because I wrote an overview of CopperSpice as we were going along before we worked on the API documentation. And the overview was, again, talking about the tool chain, talking about how to use what we were doing. And it was very interesting. Then as we were working on the test loop and compiling everything, it was like, wait a minute, how do I use my own product? I know, I'll read my documentation. I will admit how many times it was wrong. It was embarrassing, and it was just between the two of us working in tandem, and it's like, what were we thinking? So we got in the habit of every time we compiled, whether it was a test suite, a CopperSpice, or then something with DoxyPress, we didn't do it by just that's what we type. We actually did it by using our own documentation. And after about a year, it was a little better, and it actually kind of works. So that's why we support it. DoxyGen started about in the mid-90s. It's a great product. We're not against it. It just hasn't migrated forward the way we would want it. Some of the things that aren't as obvious is some of the internals, and we're going to cover some of that so you know what we did and why. One of the things is, and again, I'm talking DoxyGen right now in terms of what they have, not the wizard, but just terms of DoxyGen. Inside, if you're familiar with Qt, they're still using today. The Qt 1.9 classes for containers, for strings. And the way they're doing translations is not standard, and it's all maintained by hand. Yes? I'm sorry? Oh, in terms of the translations, yes, French, Spanish.
Yes,
in terms of the translations of French and German and Japanese, the way the translations are done, it's not in an easy, they have to be done by hand. They are maintained by hand. So
one particular issue you'll find as you look through the document source code and attempt to understand it is noted the ternary operator. It's not necessarily a bad thing. It's part of the language. You should understand it. However, when you have the ternary operator and both of the second and third arguments to the ternary operator are themselves ternary operations, it becomes almost impossible to read. I would recommend avoiding this in the code. And having parameters that are the same name as member variables in your class really doesn't help comprehension.
So what really happened was we developed proper specs. We did a release, and we had the overview. So, okay, now we need the API. We sat down, and we had done everything with Oxygen. And then it occurred to us, something's wrong. And I tried for about a week or two to make Doxygen work. No matter what we did, it would not document proper specs, mostly because of our templates, some macros. It was not an easy decision to take Doxygen and move forward to DoxyPress, but it was the right choice. And it did take about 2 or 3 weeks to really decide. We did want to improve Doxygen to upstream. That wasn't going to work for many of the reasons we're going to show. So we really had to take what they had in Doxygen and create DoxyPress. There is an antenna. There is an antenna. There are 3 or 4 people, I may be off on the exact numbers, there are a couple of people that contribute, but everything goes through one antenna, and it's rigorous to get things accepted through that. But again, he's not going in a C++ direction, which we're going to show on why we felt that going with DoxyPress and creating something new, we just couldn't document our own API for our own library. There's just no way to do that. And we're going to show you some examples of why. And here's one of them. There's macros used to simulate variadic templates, raw pointers, and we're going to show you an example of how they simulated variadic templates.
One of the things which we noticed as we started going through the code, however, is the variable, particularly the names for loop variables. And when we reached a point inside a deeply nested piece of code where the loop variables that were visible at that point were II, LI, LLI, and LII, we realized that something had to be done with this code. It was super unmaintainable.
We do tandem programming. I do the majority of typing. So we use the standard continuously. And we're using our Diamond editor, which is a nice editor, but I'm having to blow the fonts up really large. Because with both of us wearing glasses, it was really hard after a while to tell the difference between an L and LI. It isn't readable code, and there's no range-based fours, because he hasn't updated Doxygen. Again, great product, I want to make sure I say that, but this is not, to me, readable code. So it's going to be hard to maintain.
There's another issue, as Barbara alluded to, the container classes that are used in Doxygen from a very old version of Qt were actually hand-copied out of that version of Qt into the Doxygen code base. And they're pointer-based, not value-based. No raw pointers. And they use this auto-delete memory management where for any given object, you select one container that owns that object. And when you remove that object from the container, it is automatically deleted. This is a wonderful tool for creating very hard-to-find memory leaks to use after free apps. There was another problem. That container library did not have a set container. So what do you do if you have no set, but you do have an associative container similar to map? Well, you create a map from the key that you would like to a void star, and you cast a suitably ugly number to a void star to use as the value in your container, thereby ensuring that if anybody ever uses the value, they would get a 666 and the ugly value.
We did test through the code because just deleting this and removing this and actually using the appropriate container said, no, we don't want to do that quite yet until we're sure. And it isn't always 666. There's a couple of different values that were being used and that are currently there. And once we realized that it was all to get, through not having map, it was like it all went away. The other thing is there was also some, every container had to be initialized to value.
Yes. The Mac class that was used had to be initialized with a prime number that specified the size of the hash table you would like it to use, because that was not automatically determined. It just added complexity to the code that wasn't necessary. The real problem in this area was not in the container library itself. It was the fact that many of the classes in DoxyCode inherit from containers and add functionality.
This wasn't actually obvious at first, because if you look at the beginning, and yes, it is a qdip, and it's a file name dip, when you're looking at file list, it's not actually obvious it's a container until you go through the whole tree. So here we are working together and going, why does this container bother me? And it actually took a while for us to go, well, it's just a class, it has members, something's wrong. And it really took us a while to realize that they're actually inheriting. And we've noted here that QList is just basically STD list.
So if you want to walk through one of these data structures, you have to understand that what you have is effectively a map, where the key is a string, and the value is a raw pointer that points to an object that has some additional information, but is also a list of raw pointers to other objects. It's very difficult to maintain consistency in this structure.
We're not a fan of raw pointers. We did actually decide SharePoint was the way to go at the time that we decided to take the hit. And some of these classes actually still exist. We still need to retrofit some of these classes and change the way the inheritance works. But we switched everything to SharePoint. We took a really bad hit for about 4 to 6 weeks. The first compile, I think, changing all the declarations to SharePoint, we had over 20,000 lines of errors. And it was just painful, but we made it true and removed.
There's another problem with the DoxyCode code. Obviously, if you're writing a documentation program, you're going to be working with strings extensively. Documentation is string-based. The string class that is used has an issue. It's actually common to all of the containers. It is worse in the string usage. And the problem is, if you access an index off the end of a string, you don't get an error. You don't get a seg fault. You don't get an exception. What you get is a null character.
And this works in DoxyCode perfectly. He's expecting it to be a null character to know that he's gone out of bounds.
So effectively, a string consists of the data plus an infinite number of null characters after that. So it's perfectly legitimate using this type of string class to test using that without testing whether the string is long enough.
And then when we changed over, because we use copper spice, not Qt 1.9 for our containers, and the first time, and we're developing on Windows most of the time, and then testing everything on Debian and Mac, and this just creates a nice error that is only solvable using printfs and about 2 or 3 days of hacking to try to find where does this exist.
The fundamental problem with this code, of course, is it doesn't actually say what it means. So the first translation that we had to do was to go through the code and bar all of these tests to make sure that the size was large enough before we tested a string. However, with a modern string class such as QString, you can actually state explicitly what you're testing for, and all of a sudden this code becomes more readable.
What became a problem though was realizing that we actually had to grab the entire source code for act. Find all these. We've tracked almost all of them down. One popped up about 2 weeks ago, because it depends on what path you're going through in the code. We are fixing them. We're getting some better tool chains, but they are painful to find. Sure. Using
libClang to help us find all the paths. That's an interesting question. We weren't using libClang at that point, so that wasn't feasible.
At the time we were actually doing this about a year ago, where some of this happened, libClang wasn't fully working on Windows. So we've been sort of standing behind the claim to kind of pushing it forward.
Question? so many locations that that didn't actually help. The problem was not so much finding the locations as actually reading every one and checking visually whether it was correct. And that's the...
We do believe we've chased them all down at this point. Now, what we want to mention is this is one of the other things that Docs do have. This is a place where he's got a macro, and he needs to pass three parameters. He's not using templates. He's not using variadic templates at all. And there's three different, obviously, parameters passed to nine different forms based on a data type. That probably wouldn't be so bad, except it's not just for all three. Actually, of this, there's nine. And then if you click on it, for all six, there's two forms. You can see there's lots of different forms. For 401, there's 12 forms. It's about 200 lines of code. There's a comment in the code.
There's a comment in the code that says, this probably should be replaced by some templates, but I'm not sure how.
So we decided we should do this. This is a sample of one of his macros. And as a macro goes to the 403, it's nothing particularly that interesting. It's just a couple lines. But then we took it and decided, yes, let's make it modern C++. This relates nine lines of code to replace 200 lines.
It reduces the complexity of the code base. It reduces the number of strange problems you have that all of a sudden you call this function with a new set of arguments that wasn't previously declared in the macro. Of course, it only acts if it just works.
So this is one of our optimizations. Now, we actually want to switch into the parsing and how we started to approach this. So I'm going to go over what parsing is. Parsing is a two-step process normally. Again, if you're just writing a small application that's just doing some parsing by hand, you're probably not going to be using Lex and Bison. But if you're doing some intense parsing, it's a two-step process. Lex is lexical analysis, which is taking your input and generating tokens. That's its whole purpose. The second step is using something like Bison to take those tokens and then turn it into an abstract syntax tree in AST or something that makes sense. This is how parsing is normally done as a two-step process. However, that is not how Doxygen works. Doxygen uses Lex only. It does not use Bison. I've written some parsers, but they're just little ones by hand. Here I was learning Lex. Oh, how exciting. It's wonderful. And then one day, Ansel was looking over my shoulder at some of the stuff I was doing, because I'm like the parser person, and he started laughing. He goes, you do know Bison is missing. And I said, I have no idea. Is that why I'm tearing my head off? Not only that, but in Doxygen, there are a couple different parsers. But there's the C-style parser that is responsible for all the C, C++, C-sharp, objective, a teeny bit of D, all the way through. I think there's two different forms of IDL. I'm not an IDL expert. Java, JS, and PHP. There are, so if you actually were to look at the Lex code, over 800 different scenarios, which do become the cases and the switches later, once the Lex gets generated. The problem is, which language is which one goes with? And it's not clear. So let me show you some samples of this.
As an example of one of the rules, so this is a rule that will match an identifier when you're in the process of looking for a class variable. So this is probably inside the body of the class, depending upon what has come before. There are several different states that you can be in during the body of the class. And you can see that we have tests for all the various different languages that we could possibly have and special case keywords. Because, of course, if you're in C#, where is a keyword that is special, and could that be a method name, and things like that. The problem becomes, what about this case down here? Is this handling C++ 11 file? Is it handling Java file? Is there an Objective-C file, a non-Objective-C expert? I'm not sure. Is there a file in PHP? If we change this line of code, will it mess up us in PHP?
Over the course of time, as we've been working with DoxyPress and stuff, we wanted to enhance some of the parsing. We were doing some various projects. And in these projects, it became very difficult because every time we looked at modifying one of these, we had to make sure that the code we were going to put in for some of these other projects, that we didn't break what we had. We didn't want to break PHP. We were going to do some extensive C++ parsing. And it was complicated because I've got to be able to tell where I've got a class. So almost everything had to become, if it's this and something else, makes the code really complicated, very buggy, and Lex code is actually really hard to read on some of the output if you've read Lex code on the debugger.
Now, there's another issue with this system, which is if anybody here is a Lex expert, I'm an exercise for you. If you didn't have these comments down below, could you figure out which language these rules were parsing?
The top three lines we snagged from the top of this. This file has about 9,000 lines of code in it to do the 800 rules. So those are the top ones. Ansel is the expert person in regex stuff. I can understand the comments, I understand what it does, but these are comments that are actually in the code.
Now, another thing I'll note here is this skip curly state dealing with what looks an awful lot like some comment syntax. The preprocessor is the same class as the parser in this Lex document code, which makes it extremely difficult to parse many preprocessor constructs correctly.
And there's a problem with understanding the regex of when there's no forward and backward. So it's only going forwards. So once you're in a state, that's the state you're in. You can't go back and say, oh, well, now I'm in the wrong state, go backwards. If you think you're in the wrong state, you've just got to store some information and then hope you can figure out the next trail. So there's lots of languages that are parsed in here. New rules have to be added every time. For CopperSpice, we did add about 50 rules dealing with some of our macros. We sort of got it working. And then we looked at each other and said, what are we doing? This is ridiculous. We should be using Clang. Oh, by using Clang? Well, we're only moving the C++ into Clang, obviously. We're going to leave everything, and our approach has been to take this file, and then we're going to rip out all the C++ parts. We hope. We hope we don't damage to kill.
Why don't we just kill PHP
support?
There are actually people who use it for PHP. And
yes. We want to actually enhance it so everybody moves over, is our approach. But right now, we have actually, somebody sent us an email and said, it looks like you care mostly about C++. We do. But we're also looking at the D community. We're working with other people on other stuff. But right now, our focus is on level C++. So we decided there had to be a better way to do this. Fortunately, we live in a great area. I met with some LLVM people. And it's like, yes, libClang. Now we can do this. libClang is a C interface. It's used by Xcode. Yay, Apple. This is great. Very well maintained. It's used for syntax highlighting. And libClang exposes the AST. We're set. Now we just have to learn libClang.
So libClang has a fairly simple mental model. You parse a file, you generate a set of cursors, and then you can walk those cursors to traverse the AST because each cursor represents a node in Clang's internal AST. This works quite well. It then allows you to move forward and backward, associating a location in the source code with the cursor and vice versa. And this is wonderful because you can really understand the structure of the code and interleave it with the text as well.
One of the problems that they have in DoxyPress is for him to keep track of your line number and column number from the source file. He does it by incrementing. So he's doing it by hand. And the line numbers are almost always wrong. One of the great things now we have with libClang is we can just ask libClang what line number we're on. Because you can use the cursor, you can use the locations, and Clang doesn't get it wrong. Which is really cool. Now we don't have to do it by hand, and we don't have to implement it definitely. So we know what line number we're on.
Now, if you search for information about libClang and how it's designed, it wasn't designed to provide all of the information in Clang's AST. It was designed to provide a set of useful externally, and to provide a nice, stable API to maintain conversion to version, So consumers like Xcode can write their interface once and use it with all future versions of Chrome. Sounds wonderful. This is exactly what we're looking for.
We're happy at this point. So it's a two-step process. And in step A, we're just doing some initialization. We're setting up the translation unit. We do decide, since we've got libClang, hey, let's flag it if there's any C++ calls. We now have this great opportunity to actually let libClang tell us. And then we walk the AST, visit the cursors, match everything up. There's a great switch, and we can check whether we're in a declaration, an enum. It's all really nice.
So at this point, we have the information about all of the entities in the translation, all the classes, functions, methods, data members, everything that exists. Then, in the second pass, we do a separate call to libClang to get the list of tokens in the translation. And we walk through that list step by step, looking for comments. And when we find a comment, we look forward or back for the entity associated with that comment. We match them up and associate them so that you can generate documentation from those comments.
So just to reiterate, in terms of, you have to understand then what a cursor is and what a token is. And a cursor is just, again, that representation of where you are on a node. A token is that very, very teeny part, whether it's an identifier, a keyword, or a separator. So knowing the difference of where you are, whether you're dealing with a cursor or a token, does become really important. And it's not, that isn't actually documented in the libclang. This is stuff you have to learn anyway. So I thought it would be good to show one of these. And I thought, oh, this is the next slide. So here's a line of code. We underlined each piece because each one of these is a cursor that we're looking at, and then is a token. So this whole thing matches on a cursor. The cursor it happens to match on is the CX cursor, CXX method. So everything, we can look at the tokens if we ever need to.
And so during this pass, this is part of the first pass, we have information about this line, this cursor. We save all the information in an internal data structure with a class called entry, that all of this information goes in. And then later on, in the second pass, we look up the corresponding entry object and we insert the documentation.
I'd like to mention that although there's a check mark in Doxygen that says, do it with client, it's not really using Chrome. There's only some very, very rare occasions that Doxygen actually uses Chrome.
And it turns out to be that it runs the lex parser over your code, and if it encounters a template declaration that is too complex to parse using lex, it can take that one statement and hand it to Clang and say, would you tell me which part of this is the name and which part of this is the template parameters?
So this is why if you're really using 11 and 14, and you see the Doxygen isn't working, and you've got your check mark for Clang, it's because it's not using Clang for all of the parsing, just for some of the hard cases. And that code is scattered in about 10 different rules in the lex parser. It is, I think I'm lost, let's ask libClang. So we're going to show a little bit of what we actually have. Oh, yes, question. Yes.
So the question was, are the comments also tokens or do you have to extract them yourself? Yes, each comment shows up as a token, with a token kind of CX comment, I believe is the spelling of that. So yes, when you iterate over the file, you will see the comments as individual tokens.
And then we have to actually look at that and decide which kind of comment it is, because the product supports Java style, and there's a couple different styles of comments. So we have code that actually says what type of comment it is, and then once we decipher that, then we put it in the correct place in our insert. Yes. What we actually do, we have some code that shows a little bit of this, of how we match them together, and it actually does an interesting thing in what kind of allows us.
Doesn't libClang allow you to access the comment of a function?
Sort of.
libClang, and there's a plug-in or an add-on, it's part of the core code, but it's not a feature that's always turned on, that allows Clang to parse Doxygen-style comments and process them. And the only comments that show up in libClang's comment API are those that Clang understands as Doxygen comments. The problem is, their list for what is a Doxygen-style comment is not complete. So there are many comments that you miss using that API.
We did try to use that approach, and it didn't work. So we did have to do it by hand. And not only that, there are other style of comments in addition to the built-in ones that we wanted to eventually be able to pick up. And so we really needed to look at the tokens. It turns out to actually not be that expensive to run this in a two-pass. We can actually show some code that may help to answer that on how we actually parse it. Is that? And if not, ask us again. So I think it's, so that's exactly what we're about to show, is here's how it's set up. So this is the beginning part. The private is, we wanted to show this, this is a subset of this private class. We wanted to make sure that we were showing the data types of how a translation unit is called.
It's fairly straightforward to use libClang, and once you have your linkage and your include paths all set up, you just call Clang Parse Translation Unit 2. We're using version 2 because it gives you an error code rather than just fail success. So you can get a little more information if the parsing fails. You pass in a bunch of information. There's a lot of data structures in here that are filled in beforehand for the command line arguments and all of the files that you want to parse.
We wanted to trim down, so we were showing you the main aspects. The bottom line is we want to get it to you. We want to get this translation unit out.
And I'll point out the CX translation unit detailed pre-processing record. This tells Clang to keep additional metadata about the parse, because if you don't pass this, it doesn't store information about comments and about macro expansions, which are important for us. And then at the beginning of our file, we set up, at the beginning of each translation unit, we have an entry, which is, again, our internal data structure where we're going to be putting information. We always need to know what the current root entry is because it's a tree of information. And then you call get translation unit parser. It gives you back this CX parser report type. And you can iterate over the parser by calling visit children. It's just recursively calls a callback function for each node of the tree.
So the first part up to here is code that is just really boilerplate. The trick is writing visitor. So here's the shape of what visitor looks like. Again, it's not really anything stark. We're just trying to, from the person, to get the pattern. We're just showing the switch, and we're dealing with all the different types. We're going to show a couple of the different switches based on it, but this is the shell of what's happening.
Then descending inside this shell, we have one case. As you might tell by the menu, this is what we get when Clang has encountered our function declaration. And this is, again, fairly straightforward. I'll call your attention to the highlighted items that you didn't get. These are just wrappers around Clang functions with similar name. The reason there's a wrapper is because there's some memory management strings that have to be disposed in the Clang API. So these are wrappers that handle that. And it's you just get the signature of the method. Name, those arguments, we put that in our internal data structures, and we're set.
So entry is a container that already exists in Doxygen that we're leveraging. The truth is, it's not designed all that well. But what we wanted to do in this pass was just leverage entry, produce this, and see some output. And that was actually quite amazing. It worked quite flawlessly on that. Once we're done designing this whole parser section, we are then going to go back and completely redesign it because it's not done well. Now, as you can see in here, we've got section name type. To figure out what went in here, we had to go back to the Lex parser, back to those 800 different rules for everything. And we had to find what is saved and what is needed. one of the keys you were mentioning is how do we match up the comment set? That's the really cool one with the get person USR. That's part of what we save in our entry map, because that USR becomes a unique identifier. So once we then get the comment, we can match it with that USR. And that allows us to then have the comment be associated in the same entry.
And the really nice thing about the USR is that it's a unique identifier for every entity in the claim AST that is unique and consistent across translation means. So we have a nice way to tie all of these together without worrying about what was included for which translation mean.
That was actually a little bit of a scary point if we couldn't have linked that together nicely. It was going to be a little bit more work, and then that piece just snuck into place. Here's another example.
So this is the case that you get to when you're traversing a class declaration and you're inside the inheritance list. This is a base class that appears in the inheritance list.
Writing most of this code in here, it does take time. What takes more time is going back and looking up in the list. But as you can see, we can tell the difference between a class and a struct. We've left out the code that then saves it to an entry, because then it will fit nice on the slide. What we were really trying to show is there's great stuff in libClang that we can actually find exactly what we want to know.
And when we're dealing with a method declaration, quite straightforward, again, just like function, we get some information, we can ask, is this method virtual? Is it pure virtual? Now, I'll call your attention to a non-Clang issue here. You can see that when we discover a method is pure virtual, we have to save that information in four distinct places. Because we have to add virtual to the return type of the function, we have to set its specifier to pure virtual, we have to add the equals zero manually to its argument list so it will come out on the other end, and we have to set a pure specifier in another data structure.
This is why we want to change how entry works. But again, we wanted to see output. We were very eager to see it. So right now, we haven't changed how entry works. And this code actually does work. And it does actually mark everything as virtual or pure virtual. So we don't have a problem. But it's obviously not where we want to be eventually. There should be just some notation that said, this is pure virtual. It shouldn't require this much.
But recall that we said a little while ago that the libClang is not designed to expose the entire Clang AST. It's really designed to expose the pieces that Xcode needs.
And there was a few problems. And this was the first one we hit, but not catastrophic. Since we have a person, we can get the token. So we call Clang token out. And if you notice on this for loop, what we're actually doing is walking the beginning of a declaration looking for the open parentheses. Because it turns out libClang doesn't allow us to ask for const expert or anyone. So there's no way to do it with the cursor. Minor limitation, but hey, we're good, we've got tokens. And all we have to do is once we get the const expert, we can just save it to our type and we can prepend it. Not so terrible.
A little awkward, a little annoying.
However, it turns out, yes. The question was, were we going to modify libClang? We actually ended up having some conversations with some Clang team. And we asked them, is this of value to you? Would you like us to fix libClang? And they said, Apple's happy if you want to go ahead. But that may not be the right approach. And they're aware that we were doing this. So they said, have fun. This is where it was.
And also our general impression was libClang is always, by its nature, going to be a little behind in what it can expose. And if our goal is to keep up with the newer standards, that may not be the best way to go.
But this didn't bother us too much.
This was solvable.
This was very solvable. We can use this, and it kind of works. And then we said, but the problem that we found out is we couldn't get default values, const expert, volatile. We started running into a lot of problems. Friend is where we started to really wonder if we were doing it correctly. So now in friend, there's no way to do any of the libClang parsing. That's okay. I already know how to parse before parentheses and after. And that's when we stopped. because we realized, wait a second, now I've got the argument list. I'm going to have to recursively call all of our stuff to figure out how to parse what's in between the parentheses. At which point, we ended up running into some plain people saying, are we doing this right?
You to
us. No. And they said, when we said the AST isn't police report, we meant it. And again, we said, should we fix it? And they said, you can fork it if you like. You can submit patches. We started to look at some of the code, and it was like, ouch. We were then told, stop using libClang. You should be using libClang. That's what we were told by some people that we trust. But the cool part is, everything we already got out of the Lex parser, we can use that. But now we have to completely drop libtooling at this point. And so we need to go to libtooling, drop libclang. And we have everything we've already got for the entry system. So then we started trying to read some online documentation for libtooling, of which there is not much.
So we started looking at various presentations that were given. And they all seemed to start on step two. So we decided to take a minute and fill in step one, at least the broad strokes. The structure of libtooling is such that what you need to do when you want to use libtooling is inherit from a few internal client classes and override various virtual methods in those classes. And there's a lot of machinery around it. You need an AST consuming, you need an AST front end action. Those are actually fairly small, and you can find examples of those. The actual work happens in the recursive AST visitor class. This is a class that has an overloaded method for each type of information that can be encountered while you're traversing the client AST.
So our point then is we're going to now with the plan and that code which we've generated and moved to libtooling, we're going to take that information and we're just going to put it in here. So we haven't really lost any work. It's just, again, a little more code to put everything back in here. And now we have a choice with libtooling. Do we want to use the very current release? Do we want to use the nightly build? We have lots of choices on what we want to use.
And we are assured, since we're accessing the plain AST directly without an intermediate layer, that any construct that plain understands will be available in this API. We're overriding a virtual function.
And this
is showing our declaration in the parent class, it is virtual.
It does compile it now. It doesn't link yet, but it compiles.
We're working on that.
We have a link problem. So that's where we're at with the libtooling, is deciphering the include files. Now that was trial and error. We got that working. The problem is deciphering the libraries you need to use libtooling. Turns out to be very complicated.
This is one of the places where libclang is far superior to libtooling, because libclang is a single shared library if you're on a Unix platform, or a single DLL if you're on Windows, and you link with that, and it's done. Whereas libtooling is not actually a library. It's a collection of static libraries that consist of most of plain. And asking the question, which static libraries do I need for which portion is not a trivial question.
In
what order?
We found,
that is also a part.
We found a project on GitHub, I don't remember the exact name of it, but when you actually read the library, and the library names, it was like library A, library B, library A, library B, C, then the next line was B, A, C, B, A, A, B, C. And we got back it, it's like trial and error. When there has to be a better way. Yes.
That is true. The project manager does have the ability to recurse in the library list. That doesn't work on Windows, unfortunately.
And we're supporting all platforms, so that didn't.
On Windows, the order is important if you are not using Microsoft.
Which
is
the same thing. We're using Windows, yes.
A lot of people do not go with versions of the SEC.
Yes. So that's the great information we've achieved in the past couple of days, is we're not actually building this in tree with LLVM. Because if we were doing something like kind of tidy and stuff, and it's in tree, it's easier to find that out. So what we do need to do, and we have found out this great information, is by then building the CMake files and putting it in, you can go back and ask CMake, hey, what should we have done? So that is going to be the solution to that piece.
So we expect to be making significant progress on that shortly.
By the weekend, yes. And the question was about supporting what they're doing with libClang. One of the things that when we first were compiling Clang on Windows, we did it, I think, about 3 days after it barely was supported, about a year ago, and the documentation was really awkward. So that was one of the first things we did, is up on the website, they didn't have DoxyPress, that was the problem. I actually have some documentation on our website, which is really cool, because I actually forgot how to build it. When we moved from 3.6 to 3.7 or 3.8, and I had to look at my own documentation, found an error, and I fixed it. So we have documentation of how to build Clang on Windows, which is, it's not complicated, but you've got to put a lot of pieces in the right place.
Yeah, and I'll put a footnote on that. It's not just how to build Clang on Windows. It's how to build Clang on Windows using WinGW as your tool chain. And if you ask that question on the Clang mailing list, the answer is usually something along the lines of, why would you do that? Well, unfortunately, that's what we had to do, because at the time, Clang didn't support exceptions on Windows, and MSVC didn't support some of the other features we needed, so WinGW was the only tool chain that had all of the features that we needed.
And since we're supporting all platforms, we have to use our lowest common denominator, which is Windows WinGW.
So I would like to shift direction slightly and talk a little bit about lessons learned during this process and part of what we discovered trying to migrate a large legacy code base to modern C++. And the first one that we discovered was extremely confusing, was ensure your copy constructors are deep copies, or sometimes you might have a type that is not a value type, then that copy constructor isn't a deep copy. That's fine. What you shouldn't have is a class that has a copy constructor that does a shallow copy and also has a deep copy method. Because you never know when you're dealing with an object whether it shares state with another object or not. This was extremely difficult to untangle throughout the code base. And
yes, question. Yes, it was. Since every container was raw pointer, and of course we got rid of everything associated with the auto delete, it became extremely difficult to know ownership. And we didn't know in which destructor who's going to delete anything. The number of news with free problems, it is a mess. That ownership has all been cleaned up by moving to shared pointers. We did have somebody suggest that maybe we used a few too many shared pointers and had actually said only new grads use shared pointers. So there was a comment that said, we can tell that you rank beginner programmers because real programmers only use raw pointers. At which point we said, that's okay, we like shared pointers. And so it was an actual Reddit post. So
But you're right that these first two issues are kind of tied together.
Yes.
And the way I would tie them together is to say, if you have a type that's not a value type, its name should probably end in PTR. Because it is very difficult when you have a large category of types in your program, and you can't tell which ones have reference semantics versus value semantics versus pointer semantics versus a mixture of value and pointer semantics.
This is why we took the hit in over a 7-week period, because we did try, but we convert a few. And then it was, we ended up with raw pointers over here and shared pointers over here. Any code that you're going to translate and get rid of all the raw pointers, just start and know you're not going to compile for a couple of weeks. And just do it as one inhale and then exhale, which is what we did.
But that is the only path that works. You cannot add smart pointers to a large legacy code base incrementally.
Beginner two, welcome. Well, and the question is, should we have used a unique pointer? What we or do it incrementally? Yeah, to do it incrementally. The advantage of actually moving to shared pointers, it did make the code more readable, more maintainable. There actually was a speed increase as well, which was amazing. And fixing destructors and finding errors sooner, that was also an advantage.
One thing that I often say is my reason for using shared pointers in projects, specifically shared pointers, although other smart pointers help with this as well. I had experience with this in a large code base. And what I discovered was when you use smart pointers, it turns every kind of memory problem that you would have had before into a memory leak. And we have tools for finding memory leaks. So once you migrate to smart pointers and your code is leak free, it is probably correct when it's memory management. Yes, it is possible that you could do an incremental step of using unique pointer and having the compiler help you find where the sharing is. In this particular code base, that wouldn't help because everything is shared in many different data structures. So,
the overall number of containers is still needs to be reduced down if that part's important. Yes. And then ownership problems became obvious. The other problem was there were no range-based for loops. Actually, there were iterator problems all over the place.
The container library that was being used Java-style iterators, which were extremely awkward in most cases. And again, the other problem with this container library is the way you tested for being at the end of the sequence was by continually incrementing and dereferencing it. And when you got a null pointer back, you knew you were at the end of the sequence. Except if somebody inserted a null pointer into the sequence, in which case all of the elements after that point were unreachable. Unless you kept track of how many nulls were in the sequence and knew how many you had to skip over before you got to the real null that told you you were at the end of the container.
And keep in mind, as we mentioned, this is Qt 1.9. He's still using these containers. That's fine, but they aren't being updated. So if you were to look at current DoxyGen code now, you're still going to see these things there. We just cleaned everything up in DoxyPress because this is where we wanted to move forward with it. And there was a lot of misuse of containers. We've shown some of it. There's no overrides they had. We've added those, kept with compilers. There's a lot of containers in the product. And we're going to be reducing some of those down. But the biggest thing is by throwing in overrides, it allowed us to figure out what classes were actually associated together, because it's not always obvious. And then take the fun of UTF-8. I still have a headache.
Yes.
I don't even know what to say. It was a couple of weeks of a nightmare. None of his string classes support anything with UTF-8 the way we would want.
The real problem with the string classes that we used in DoxyPress is the fact that it was a string class that internally it was not encoding a way. Most of the strings in the program were in UTF-8. Some of them were not. The string class had an automatic conversion operator to character stock. Not const character stock, but character stock. So quite often, you would pass a string to some other method, which would receive it as a character stock, modify the original string, and then call some other method, which took a string object. So now you had two copies of the string, but the original one had been mutated. It was extremely difficult to track that down and do the proper mutation semantics through all of the functions. There was extensive use of character pointers and const character pointers all over the code. It was impossible to track down memory management problems, and we didn't even try. We just got rid of the little pointers.
There's a lot of places in the code where he wants to actually walk a string by hand, and he walks it as a character star, and it is some intense code to read. And we've cleaned up a lot of it, because if you're using modern C++ 11 or 14, we're still maintaining 11, you really can clean up the code and make it far more readable.
And the takeaway from this is, if you are writing code that does a non-trivial amount of work with human natural language text, and you're not using a Unicode-aware string class, your program is probably going to mess up somebody's character encoding.
So again, this is one of those, do it in the beginning. Retrofitting's annoying. Yes.
So the question was, do we pass the standard strings by value or by const reference? We actually use QString because we're using proper specs, so we're using that string class, but it's equivalent in semantics. And most of the code passes by const reference. We've maintained that whenever possible. There's actually, if we were passing by value, there's quite a few places where copies would be made, even with the new direction to prefer passing by value than by reference. It wouldn't be a learning mistake.
Give us about 6 weeks. We are taking QString in CopperSpice, and we are removing it from, we're completely throwing QString out of CopperSpice, and we promise UTF-8.
And UTF-8.
No copy on write. We are. Yesterday we actually showed that we released a signal slot library, and that we wanted to do first. The next thing on the list is QString. And this also gives us the advantage of our new signal slot library. It can be BSD instead of signal without GPL. We're going to completely redo QString, and that way we can also do BSD, because we're going to release it as a completely written thing. QString is, and if you're not familiar with it, it is very similar to SCD string. It is a lot of extra methods and a little different API. We're going to do it in a way that we maintain what people with STD would want, the SDL library, and if you're a Q, the CopperSpice user, so that everybody gets everything. We're going to maintain both APIs. Yes?
So the question was about using free functions instead of member functions for all the functionality of string. And that is certainly a direction to look in. The API of QString we want to keep, so it's familiar to users of Q or CopperSpice, so that there'll be methods with the appropriate names. It's not clear how the free function situation will work, because one of the important things about a proper encoding aware string class is that it actually has metadata about what encoding it contains, or this is always UTF-8. And if you have free functions, there's the risk that you may use that in some other container that isn't E2F phones and get very minimal results. That is true.
One of the other things with parsing is some of the methods are value semantic, some aren't. And it's quite annoying using parsing right now, although it has a nice API, but it's like, wait a second, which one was the value semantic, which one wasn't? So again, we're going to fix that so that we're using value semantics, we're going to leave the other things in there. There's going to end up being a lot of functionality in parsing so that people who've used it in the past, people like me who are tired of trying to remember to put the equal sign in, don't have to keep asking because you look it up, because I can't remember this one. So there are several methods. This thing is also missing a few things. I'm really tired of mid. I would like substring. This is just some of the quirks. And this is where it's fun to be a library maintainer. It's like, yes, let me add everything I want. It's good to be clean. Okay, you can be a king. So we do have future plans. What are they? Well, this is what we've done so far. We're not using Qt 1.9. We are using DoxyPress. We've done a lot of reformatting. The code doesn't look the same anymore at all. It's actually a lot more readable, a lot more friendly. It doesn't take 3 days to find an at zero error anymore. It takes about 2 hours now. We're using 11. That makes sense. And we did change the project file from a Lex parsed raw text file to JSON format. I understand there's no comments allowed in a JSON file, but it's a far easier format to work on. And for anybody who saw earlier versions of DoxyPress, we have made the JSON file so it does look more like a tree. And it's all segregated and made a lot of people happy by not having it look just like a flat file. So that's been enhanced. We do have DoxyPress app, which is a complete rewrite of the Doxygen wizard. So we have that, and the help system is a lot more enhanced. We've also had some great beta testers looking at what we've done and made a lot of comments like, gee, I had a Doxygen file, raw text file, don't make me import it and convert it in your app. Let me do it at the command line. So things like that have been coming. So yes, we can convert any Doxygen file over to our JSON file. Happen automatically.
Where are we not yet? We haven't completed the integration with Parse. You mentioned a lot of the challenges with LibClang and linkage and things like that. That's underway. We need to redesign the internal containers, get it so that parsers don't import from containers recursively in a large complicated data structure. There's an issue with the memory usage of Doxygen, which is that all of the data is loaded and then serialized to bits, and then as the tree is walked, the data is repeatedly loaded and saved back to bits continuously, which is extremely inefficient and doesn't make good use of time on systems with a large amount of memory. So this whole marshalling, demarshalling, serialization mechanism needs to be rethought and probably simply removed. Exactly sure how that's going to shape up at the moment.
And again, we're going to redo the entry. We have done a tremendous amount of cleanup on the HTML output. That was also something we ran into right in the beginning, that the HTML, most of it just wasn't even accurate. You couldn't tell. Instead, you really started opening the files and reading everything. We can follow the same XML, docbook, all the other outputs, but we haven't looked at them enough in terms of somebody saying something is missing. And we know that possibly working with Boost on this, this was a really interesting thing. Probably about a month or so ago, we actually ran Boost Drive through DoxyPress. We had some dependency issues that it was just trying to pull in so much that it was hard to tell. But what was amazing is we were looking at the output and it was like, cool, DoxyPress actually understands some of the template stuff. So that was a really interesting invention, and it is our hope to work with the Boost team and to make sure that we can use DoxyPress somehow with what you're doing to make sure that we can improve the documentation and we actually had some requests to work with a couple other different products as well. And we've also been approached by a couple people in the D community that it's like, we would like DoxyPress to work with D. I have seen the Swift people online. I haven't seen the D people online. And I love you. It would be really nice if D. Yeah. We are planning to, we've actually added a parser for a couple of things, like for some make files and stuff, because in some of our debugging, we were getting annoyed. So we've actually added some other outputs. That is the intent, is to take this mess and to split it out appropriately. So PHP is separate. We haven't done much work in the Fortran parser. So that one's still, somebody's about to come along and say, I want to do that. But yes, we want them separate. So that the Fortran person and the PHP person and the Perl and I'm running out of languages, and there's a couple of the Tickle. So there's a Tickle parser. The Tickle is separate, Fortran is separate. But yeah, we do want to tear this apart.
And direct answer to your question is we'll know of other languages that have parser libraries because we haven't looked into that. But obviously for any languages that have an existing parser as a library, that's the correct way to document. I'm not sure that the D parser
is
because I believe one of the major D implementations is a front end for LLVM.
Yes.
So there may well be an opportunity there. Obviously, it depends on the language, but there are certainly other languages that have parsers that are available that we can call from C++.
And if anybody wants to help us write those parsers, they're not quite available. We're open to that. Yes. There's actually, if you really start tearing apart it, there's a different parser that's used for the macros before Doxygen actually does the C++. So there's actually a front-end parser, a middle parser, an end parser. It's actually, if I drew a map, it would be like that, because it's actually going in and out of parsers. And then there's a comment parser. So the actual Lex parser gets some information and says, oh my gosh, I think I have a comment. So it spawns over here to this comment, and then it says, oh, well, that's an HTML thing. I'll just stash it over here, and then I'll come back. So if you're reading the debug code, it's very interesting. It's like, which parser am I in now? That needs to be streamlined. But as I'm sure you can appreciate, we need to do one step at a time, and we're trying to do the most critical ones, which is 14's out, 17's coming. We need to be ready. So really, we need to make sure that we understand all the pieces. The TS is around. So we need to make sure that we can actually parse everything, cleaning up some of that stuff. It's a piece at a time. And what else was I going to do? It's fun. When the clicker stops working, so it hits the space bar. We did just want to briefly mention that Copper Spice is a derivative work of Qt. We're up on GitHub with CopperSpice and DoxyPress and the DoxyPress app. We have binaries and source available on our website. If you're a Qt user and you want to switch over to CopperSpice, I've written a parser, PepperMel, which will convert your headers. The CS Signal library, which we're looking at, it takes boost signals too to a new level because we do thread-aware signal and slot processing. if you didn't see our talk yesterday and you want to chat with us, just let us know. And for those of you who are really excited, I'm just doing a presentation, a double presentation tomorrow, announcing LibGarden. So if you are a multi-threading person or interested or wondering if you have any race conditions, you really don't want to miss this talk because he's going to explain a better way. A better way to multi-threading. If you're interested in copper spice and you're like, what does it do? We came up with Kitchen Sink. And Kitchen Sink is mostly demos from the Cute arena, but it's all in one demo. So it's about 30 demos, and it does link with copper spice. It has not been necessarily optimized. We just wanted to show some basic demos. Some people were saying, well, we don't know what's all in copper spice. If you are a Windows person, not that Diamond doesn't work on other platforms, if you happen to think somebody would like Crimson, which I did, but it's antiquated and it stopped working, Diamond is an editor. Again, it's on all different platforms, obviously. It does use the copper spice libraries. I like Diamond, and it's a fun little editor to use.
There's all our information. You can contact us, please. All of the code that you've seen is, of course, available for download on GitHub. You can find it from our website. The forum, ask your questions, comments, concerns, and we look forward to working with you to improve documentation in the C++ world.
And Signal Library is already up. I'm just going to post LibGarden right after this talk. So, are there any questions we can answer? Oh, yes. Yes, we have now. That was the question. I want to say this gently. I mean, the question of going out there, I know this sounds weird to say now since what's happening with Bruce, but it was like we were sitting there like over the past month going, I wonder if we could get the interest of Boost. I mean, it was just the two of us sitting there going, how do we approach them? What do we say? And we are very happy to do another output. We don't want to take away any of the outputs that are there. But we really do know the internals. And you're right, we have to clean up some of them. We're doing it a piece at a time, programming as fast as we can. This is our open source stuff. I'm working on it very much full time. Ansel still has a day job for right now. But we love open source. And we really want to make this better. And although copper spice is where we started, DoxyPress has become sort of an accident, but a real one. For what we're doing. And we really want to make another output that works. I mean, if taking the XML output works, or just going straight to something that works. We do know the insides. And it turns out that it's not faster to have worked that way, because right now, as we're working on the parsing, we still have all the great rest of it that we didn't have to work with it. There is an insane amount of code that it then takes to separate everything and all the methods and the classes and the functions. And there's a lot of different patterns. We were talking about the groups and how the groups were done. Groups weren't something that I used a lot. We had a person who's come in and started looking, and he said, you missed this and this. And we've been cleaning all those up for him. And I actually said, just give me a test lead. And he goes, you got it, here it is. So we do have a full test suite. We actually have another test suite we generated to test libClang. And if anybody wants to see that, we do have that, which actually shows that libClang can actually really work, even though that's not the direction we're going. But it's some really intense C++ code pushing the language pretty hard for parsing. But we feel like doing it a piece at a time is easier. Because even if the output, that code isn't gorgeous, it's working, and we can clean it up as we go along.
There's another piece to this, which is if we were to throw out and start over, we would invariably have the situation where the internal model would either be very time-specific, or it would be very oriented towards the pieces of the DoxyPress syntax that we found useful, and we would inevitably miss one of those, you know, 5 or 10% features that's really important to some base of users, but that we never considered was important. There's actually a very rich description syntax in the comment syntax, and you wouldn't want to lose any of that along the way, or what you would have is just another project that is a documentation generator specific for one particular language and one particular project that is, you know, tailor-made for that use case. And we wanted to be more general than that. We didn't want to lose any of the generality that, you know, the internal data structures are messy, but they do understand the structure of C and C++ and Objective-C and Fortran and a bunch of other languages. That knowledge has been baked into the core.
And one of the really nice things that just happened about 3 weeks ago is the person who does the foreign language translations for DoxyGen had said, well, I produced all this really interesting stuff, but never quite got accepted. Would you like it? And he's located in Europe somewhere. And he said, give us a few weeks. We're making slides. We're really busy. Go take a look at what we have. And we just exchanged some emails with him, and it's fabulous. So he has some really interesting stuff to help us with the translations, so they're easier to maintain. So we're starting to attract maintainers that are coming on board, which is quite exciting. Yes. They haven't contacted us. We did initially try to work with them, and upstream we were considering that, and it was just, no, that's not a good approach. We've been told by some people in the middle that it's like upstream is not the way you want to go, and just make the project awesome. The interesting thing is most people that we've run across that have used DoxyGen, they're always like, HTML is broken, this is broken, that's broken, and most people are like, well, I just want to write the documentation and use the tool. It's just, give me the tool. Whereas we're kind of excited about, cool, tell us what you want it to look like, and we'll make it. So I guess we're in a very interesting position that we're willing to do that part, and other people are willing to use it. My guess is the number of issues that still exist in DoxyGen that aren't being fixed that we're addressing. People will migrate as an opinion. Yes,
So the question was, it's not a trivial task to find the appropriate entity once you've found a comment in the documentation. How do you do that? It turns out to be a tractable problem with Clang and the way that the AST is structured. It's not trivial, but it's not nearly as hard as it would be in some other contexts. And the reason is because the node in the AST knows where the beginning and the ending character are that it is associated with. So, for example, if you have a comment that comes, you know, before a method, you can walk forward. What you end up finding in the token string is the return type of the method. But if you ask Clang, what cursor is this token part of? It's part of the method, not just the return type. So it's actually fairly easy to associate back and forth between the two, you know, sort of dual views of the code, between looking at it as a string of tokens, and then from that token finding the relevant entity.
A comment is associated with that declaration.
Mm-hmm. So a comment is always associated with an adjacent declaration.
Like I said, in the test suite we have that's using libClang right now, we support all the current doxygen format ways of doing a comment, whether it's the end of the line, the beginning, and we do have a test suite which we can show you, or I believe it is actually checked in. Do you have it? Do you want to pull it up really quickly? I mean, it just shows, we have a kitchen.h file I wrote. Is it really, we tried to write the ugliest C++ code we could, but it just really went forward. This is the output. And this is using libclang. I tried to make something entertaining, sort of using the whole Olympics theme or something, trying to make it so that it wasn't just food and things.
Now, one thing that I'll call your attention to, which we're able to do with the libclang parser, and this will still be there in the clang parser as well, is, I don't recall exactly which one, but several of these methods use a training return type declaration. And in Doxygen, if you use a training return type, you will see auto here, and you will see the arrow out at the end. We don't have to do that with libclang because we actually have the full semantic information about the method. So we can display all of the methods with a consistent syntax, regardless of how they were declared in the source code.
And they also, and we were running this against, we're running side-by-side tests with current Doxygen and our current version of libclang. And there's a lot of places where spacing is off, HTML is still off, default values are still off. Some of the way the templates are looked at, it isn't what you would expect to see.
Yes, that is correct. I believe we will always change tconst to const t because that's the way it's represented internally in the plain AST. And we don't have, there are certain cases where you can end up with odd spacing with the lex parser because sometimes it pulls in white space as part of the declaration and continues that.
And it really bothered me if you're going to put a space before, put it after, make it symmetrical, make it look right. And that's, so this is what we were able to clean up in here. Mm-hmm. And that actually involved changes in how the output is generated. But we were able to clean that up for using the lib tool, or the libclang stuff.
Another thing I'll point out is this virtual here. This virtual does not appear in the source code. But we can ask Clang, is this method virtual, and get the correct answer. So now, you will get virtual out here for every virtual method, whether you use the virtual keyword in your class declaration or not.
Mm-hmm.
The same thing is true of override. You will see an override for every overridden method, whether you specify it using the override keyword or not.
And I think there's also something with default as well.
Yes. Not with final, because that's not exposed in the libclang API
yet. Final will, when we move over, yes. There's some very funny stories with how final worked that we can tell you later.
Because obviously we're getting information directly out of the AST, so it is correct by definition, because if it was wrong, Clang would be misparsing this code.
Can you go to the source so I can show where C3, C4, 5, and 6? The reason why we put those in there was, and I hope anyone can read this back there, what we really wanted to exercise is everything Doxygen is really showing. And I know there's some elements that skip. Yes, like there's a C7. We want to make sure that this should be ignored, that this C7 should be. You actually have a nice new mouse that you can use on. That's okay. So, yeah, you can see the on line 130 in here, the bool, but we don't show the auto, we show bool. And I hope it makes sense that even though we're using libclang and we're moving to tooling, we're not going to lose any functionality. In fact, we gain final. And friend, if you look at this code stuff, friend is, we're not able to parse the middle because it wasn't worth the time. So if you look at this, changes in the code. If Nook Tidy has that, that's something. I mean, obviously, we do a syntax checking on the code, which is really nice. If you're using DoxyPress app output, the output that appears on the screen, we've actually added some color coding and the way it works, and it's a lot faster. We had some people testing this with full debug on, and it was like, this is fast. So we changed some of the output so that you can read things. And it's really nice to have an arrow come up in red. Yes. We haven't looked at that yet, but it's a great idea. Yes. Dutton has the warnings, yeah.
It has.
Yes.
Set of warnings that are generated can always be improved. One of the problems that we've been working on is actually the fact that there are some false positives as well. And that's something that we're gradually able to resolve because there are contradictions in the internal data structures on occasion. And we get warnings when the original code wasn't incorrect, but it was processed in an inaccurate fashion. So yeah, there's always opportunity for improvement.
We do check on a match to make sure that what we've got, you know, declared, like it's mostly for the return type, and we do put up a warning and trying to reduce those false positives of that are showing up. We have been working on that. Yes. Yes. The question was, should we submit a patch to Clang?
Allow it to understand all the forms of documentation.
We've actually suggested to them to switch over to DoxyPress. And the Clang team has said submit a patch.
So there's in terms of integrating all the knowledge about this into Clang, it's not clear that would be a win because that would be a duplication of effort because we still need all of the warnings in DoxyPress if we're handling a language other than C or C++, or Objective-C, of course. So we would still need all of that behavior in DoxyPress. It could certainly be added to Clang. That would be helpful, because you would find out on compiling the code if your comments were like that, rather than running your documentation. But it's not clear that's the most pressing need in this area. That's an interesting idea. So the question was, if you have an environment where some type is wrong and you don't want to expose it to the user, is there some way to alias that type, make it show something else, or somehow? That actually hits a point. There's a bug in DoxyCam that actually you can document a function out of line and lie about the return type. It will treat the return type in the comment rather than the return type in the code as the type. In DoxyPress, you can still do this. You will get a warning if the return types do not match. That will work. Because obviously, the first assumption of documentation is that in most cases, it should accurately reflect the the code, but you're documenting. So it's not clear what the right answer to that problem is, where you are explicitly, consciously lying about the type behavior of your code.
We also, though, have looked at adding some stuff on the namespaces, because some of the things we've run across is namespaces, and so we added an alias to a namespace, and that got very complicated, but we're cleaning that part up so that, again, if you don't want to expose the full namespace, or it's just tremendously long. So that is something definitely new.
It looks like we're probably at time, so we're happy to take
more questions. We're happy to answer some questions, but we thought we'd let you go to lunch for those who want to, and we'll just hang out here. Thank you so much. We appreciate it. Thank you.